So we start with the first session, and I'm pleased to invite two of the three co-authors of the paper and two presenters for today. I'm from Balkans too, so I should be able to pronounce her name in the right way. So first my glasses. So Dr. Kofogionakis, did I hit it? Okay, and the colleague CJ De Young from the University of Alberta Libraries. Their topic is a progressive approach to reducing barriers to resource sharing, a Canadian example. Stage is yours.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. CJ and I are very happy to be here in this beautiful city, and we'd like to thank the National Library of Technology for hosting the conference, as well a big thank you to all the organizers. We'd also like to acknowledge our co-author, Dale Askey, who unfortunately is unable to attend. So we work at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, Canada, and CJ is the Access Services Coordinator, and I am Associate University Librarian responsible for this area. Our presentation this morning will focus on how the University of Alberta Libraries has taken a progressive approach to resource sharing and why we think this is important. So first, just a little bit of information about the University of Alberta. We service approximately 38,000 students and 15,000 employees, stretching over 5 campuses and 18 faculties. Our library is the second largest academic research library in Canada, with 10 locations that house library collections, holding more than 8 million volumes. We have a collections budget of $25 million Canadian. As one of the largest academic libraries in Canada, we actively contribute to and help shape many of the initiatives within our geographic region. Underlying everything we are going to talk about in the next few minutes is this principle from our founding president, Henry Marshall Torrey, which our university continues to embrace, that it is our raison d'etre to uplift the whole people. As a library, we continually apply this to our thinking when considering access to our resources and services. We do our best to widely bring knowledge to those beyond our campus, as well as the faculty and students that we serve. Our current university strategic plan is titled For the Public Good, also in keeping with this sentiment. So we just wanted to show you where we're situated in Canada. Edmonton is in the province of Alberta in Western Canada and is the northernmost major city of North America with a population of 1 million people. We frequently work with consortia to collaborate on many of the initiatives that we will mention today. And this ranges from the local, our NIOS consortium with a shared catalog and services, then to the provincial within the Alberta, with the Alberta Library Consortium, and regionally with the Council of Prairie and Pacific University Libraries, and finally stretching nationally with the Canadian Association of Research Libraries and the Canadian Research Knowledge Network. That's just to name a few, and there may be more that we mention in the course of the presentation. So traditionally, the resource sharing landscape has often felt the need to limit demand for fear of being overwhelmed with requests for items via interlibrary loan, for example. This has been manifested in things such as implementation of fees and charging users for filled requests. Often, resource sharing has become a service that has had to cover its own costs, resulting in the implementation of policies mandating that the borrowing library cover all costs. Such barriers to access are generally not in keeping with other services that libraries provide. At the University of Alberta, for many years now, we've been trying to move beyond fee-based resource sharing and take a good look at how we might be able to do things differently in the context of our university's mission to uplift the whole people. The rise of new technologies has helped us to think about resource sharing in new ways and shift attitudes in relation to resource sharing amongst our consortial partners for the benefit of a greater number of readers. And now we'd like to briefly highlight some of the ways that we have been progressively moving resource sharing forward in Canada, and I'm going to turn it over to CJ.
All right. Good morning, everyone. A lot of our work in interlibrary loan has been dependent on the relationships we have built through consortia. Our NEOS consortium was founded in 1992, and NEOS stood for Networking Edmonton's Online Systems, but it has expanded well beyond the city of Edmonton to a total of 18 institutions in Alberta, and they include academic, government, and hospital libraries. In these early days, NEOS selected its first ILS that would be managed by the University of Alberta Libraries. The benefits of a shared catalog over all these years have allowed for excellent resource sharing. In the early 2000s, the NEOS consortium came together to embark on the sharing of print collections. The University of Alberta, again, would act as a hub for the entire consortium to send requested items, and the hub would sort and direct the items to the libraries they needed to go. So each library is responsible for maintaining a courier connection with the hub, and this means that the interlibrary loan office at the U of A is not responsible for requests for physical items within the NEOS consortium, but rather an automated function in our system enables the sharing of physical items. There are also no charges per item requested. So the NEOS consortium does not cover all academic libraries in Alberta, but another consortium, the Alberta Association of Academic Libraries, ties all academic libraries together. To improve resource sharing with all of these libraries, a number of members came together to put forward a proposal to AAAL. This included that members would no longer charge each other. The University of Alberta Libraries backed the proposal as the largest net lender in the system. However, there were concerns from some libraries that felt uneasy about this idea. Now, why would they feel uneasy? They thought libraries would send them more requests because it would be free. Now, that might not make sense to all of us. However, we had a solution to this. So this was a pilot project. So if you want anyone to commit to something, start it as a pilot project. It's less intimidating, it requires some evaluative measures, but it's generally difficult to go back to the old way of doing things. So a pilot project was supported by the members in 2013 and evaluated in 2015, and it showed that there was no change in requesting behavior, and AAAL has continued with not charging members for ILL and document delivery. So there are four regional consortia of academic libraries in Canada, and as Denise mentioned earlier, these consortia had a national resource sharing agreement with all of their members signed onto it. It stipulated such things as the cost of borrowing items, which was $0, and document delivery, so $5 per item. The University of Toronto broke from the National Resource Sharing Agreement on May of 2016 to proceed to implement higher fees for borrowing items from them and to receive items via document delivery. So both of these would be charged $15. So here we have the problem of a slippery slope. We and libraries in Canada were concerned that with U of T's move, other libraries would follow. And so I worked with Denise and our then university librarian, Gerald Beasley, to come up with a response to the academic resource sharing community in Canada. We ended up removing all fees for document delivery and committed to maintaining no fees for borrowing items as well for members of these consortia. Our experience with NEOS and AAAL had showed us that there might be a little bit of a loss of revenue, but there would not be any changes to libraries' requesting patterns. Instead, the indirect costs of having to deal with invoicing, payments, and the errors that may occur in these processes tend to make recovering costs more expensive than it's worth. Our news was well received and came with many questions about why we would do this and how we could afford it. So I explained this to various libraries and it started conversations. Those resulted in January 2019, the establishment of a resource sharing working group that included representatives from all these consortia. Their goals included elimination of fees, lengthening loan periods, allowing renewals, and updating the agreement. The final report and recommendations have been presented to all these consortia, and it looks like they will be ratified by all. We are just waiting on OCL at this point. All right, so it's easy to share print materials from your regular collections, but it may not be so easy when it comes to items in a special collections library. However, special collections libraries have been encouraged to participate in resource sharing for a long time. Just see this quote from Hickerson and Kenny in their paper published in 1988. A number of reports have come out in more recent years that also encourage the sharing of special collections items between libraries to make these items more accessible to more researchers. In the end, the value of these items can only be tapped into when researchers are able to get their gloved hands on them. At the University of Alberta Libraries, we have the Bruce Peel Special Collections. Our focus has been to make these collections more accessible as well, and mainly through digitization. Here are just a couple of examples listed of the digitization projects of special collections material. The great thing about digitization is that the items don't have to leave their climate-controlled environment for very long and allows metadata to be assigned through the digital copy that can be viewed where the catalogs are, and it keeps the items secure. Of course, we still get requests for items that have not been digitized from our special collections, but are still subject to copyright. Therefore, we have established a guideline for providing controlled access to an out-of-print work for an approved purpose. So even though the item may still be subject to copyright for a fair dealing purpose, such as research, we will digitize an item and provide access to it as a PDF that is managed within Google Drive, and we place restrictions on downloading and printing the item, as well as expire the access after a loan period. By working out these guidelines with the Copyright Office and the Bruce Peel Special Collections, we are making progress in providing access to our special collections items. Now back over to Denise.
All right. So another way we are sharing the content that we digitize is via what's called controlled digital lending. In early 2019, so the beginning of this year, we began participation in the Internet Archive's Controlled Digital Lending Project. Controlled digital lending is the digital equivalent of traditional library lending, essentially, wherein a library can digitize a print book it owns and lend a secure digital version in place of the print version, while maintaining an own-to-loan ratio that does not exceed the number of print copies owned, and where the print copy does not circulate when the digital version is available for loan. The collection we decided to make available via controlled digital lending, as our pilot in this case, consists of materials that have been used in the school curriculum in the province of Alberta, known as the Weidrick Collection. The print copies of these materials are non-circulating and stored in secure space for preservation. Many of these we have been able to make openly accessible, and that is always our first choice, but some are still in copyright. This is where CDL comes in, so that we can make the digitized copies available for loan to anyone in the world via Internet Archive. Use has exceeded our expectations. More than half the titles have been borrowed at least once, with many on a waiting list, showing that there is greater interest in this material than we might have imagined, and certainly a population beyond our U of A campus community is using it now that it has been opened up and beyond its previous print-only restricted availability. Facilitating use via CDL is still somewhat controversial, since items are still in copyright, and many institutions are being very risk-averse about this right now. We have chosen to move forward because it supports our goals of removing barriers and enabling greater access to the collections that our university has invested in. Okay, we also want to make a brief word here on the on ebook lending and specifically for licensed ebooks in our collection. So while the shift of, in acquisition of books has gone from print to digital format, at least that is our preference, we're e-preferred, and that's improved access for our own users, it has created difficulty in sharing these resources beyond our own institution due to the licensing restrictions. Our interlibrary loan department provides chapters from digital books when permitted by licenses. However, as digital collections increase, interlibrary loan departments must address the issue of sharing whole ebooks with other libraries. Our university has recently reviewed our licenses for clauses that permit the sharing of whole ebooks, and this work guides our interlibrary loan staff with filling requests for such items. Our collection strategies team continues to work with vendors to address this issue by requesting that interlibrary loan of whole ebooks is permitted in our licenses. And we have had success with some publishers such as Brill, Springer, and Wiley. In addition, our local NEOS consortium has recently struck an e-lending working group, and CJ is on that group, to further look into this issue. And this is particularly important because of the NEOS, with the NEOS group is one that we regularly, immediately share books all the time in print, but have not had the same ability to do so for most e. And finally, we just want to make a brief mention of our involvement with shared print initiatives. To facilitate the long-term preservation and use of print materials, the University of Alberta Libraries has been an active partner in a number of shared print programs. We see our role as that of an archive builder who preserves and maintains access to content. We have been very active with the COPO Shared Print Archive Network, as well as with HathiTrust, where we have committed approximately 850,000 print items to match the existing digital surrogates within HathiTrust. We are currently involved with a national effort in Canada to form a national shared print model for the country, and with the Partnership for Shared Ebook Collections. Sorry, just books, not ebooks. I'm back on the other slide. And this is with other consortia in the US and Canada. At the center of our ability to do so much with shared print is our new research and collections resource facility building. That's the picture that you're seeing here, the inside of it, which opened in the spring of 2018. It is a state-of-the-art climate-controlled facility with capacity for 5 million items. Our commitment to retain print allows our partners to reduce their own collections while knowing they can borrow from us. So in conclusion, all these things that we've mentioned help us to build upon our mission of uplifting the whole people and moving forward in the spirit of acting for the public good by enabling greater access to the materials in our library's collection. We believe this is a positive benefit to our own user community and to society as a whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It was very uplifting. Questions? A colleague, Pavlíček from National Library.
Thank you. Could you tell us something about tools which you use for ILL of ebooks. Is there some system which you use for the ILL?
Yes, so the one that we talked about in terms of using Google Drive, which allows us to put chapters within a folder and share that. So that's one option. Uh-huh. Other options would be using Article Exchange through OCLC, which allows for larger files to be shared. So those are some options.
Thank you.
I'm Cecilia Eriksson from the National Library of Sweden. And if you said the answer to this question in the presentation, I missed it. But for this controlled digital lending, of cooperated books, did you need to make an agreement with the corporate organization of some kind, or did you just go ahead anyway?
Yeah, good question. We it was such a short overview of controlled digital lending, just because of time. But no, we just go ahead anyway. So the majority of, like, we're not talking current bestsellers or anything here. There's a lot of out of print materials, for example. And the guiding principle is that instead of the physical print book that we have, we're going to digitize and loan that copy. The print we're going to lock away, basically. And so instead, it's one for one. It's not, we're not doing anything different than if we loan the print, really. Yeah. And it is under good controls with limited borrowing time period. Only one person can borrow that book at a time.
Yeah. Thank you. More questions?
Yeah.
Oh, Mr. Gilzer.
So, my name is Bertolt Gilzer from the Bavarian State Library. Thank you for your interesting presentation. And I have questions concerning ebook interlibrary loan for licensed ebooks. The first question is, maybe it's confidential, but do you pay additional license fees for the right to lend via the library loan? And the second question is, the necessity for placing digital rights management on these documents when lending via ILL?
Thank you. So the first question around whether we pay more is no. And we do, I want to let everyone know, another thing we share is our data quite a bit around how much we pay for things. So if anybody's interested, come and find me later and we can talk about that. So because we do want people to have a better grasp on the costs of doing business, essentially. Our licenses, as we negotiate them, the publishers that I mentioned are ones where we have big deals, so to speak, for ebooks, and we generally buy complete front lists. And so part of that is a necessity that they are DRM free, and we have been able to work in the interlibrary loan clauses into those agreements as well.
Hi, my name is Flor. I'm from Mexico, but I live in Austria, and I am working in a UN library. And my question is, how do you convince the vendors to open this license to for an interlibrary loan? Because, for example, in my case, we are working with Brill, and they have a really specific agreement that you cannot open to other libraries, no? So how can you do this work with them, and how do you convince them that it's something that you need?
Yeah, that's a really hard question, just because it's not going to, like, we all have our own circumstances, of course, and what we can do. So in some ways, because we do spend a lot of money with these publishers as a large library, as opposed to smaller libraries, like, I know smaller libraries are not going to have that same negotiation power. So we're not just, you know, from Brill, we're buying their journals to all their journals and like all a lot of content. So we can really push them in terms and others. That doesn't always work to our favor either. We don't get anywhere with Elsevier on these things other than at the national level. And even there, that's very hard. So at the whole country of Canada negotiating, right? So I'm going to say there's problems for everyone. So we've been able to make some gains. I would say Springer is probably the most open on ebooks, inclusion of clauses in licenses and things like that. So that might be a place to start if you buy books from them. It's not an easy question for sure.
Carla Shalhoub from the American University of Beirut. You said that you use article exchange as a controlled digital lending, but this is for articles. When it comes to books, do you use something like Occam readers? Do you have any experience with any other software for digital lending?
So we don't use Occam's reader. So what we want to do is just be able to share the actual file. So the file, like, we use Relay ILL. If it's possible, if the file is not too large, then we can use our relay ILL system. Sometimes we would have to send it via email, but depending on the size of the file, that might not work either. So article exchange is one option. It's still just a file that you send through there.
And you set it to expire after a certain period of time, right?
For the Google Drive option, yes, we can expire the file. So within Google Drive, you have the ability to place restrictions on the document that you're sharing. So we can limit it to, you cannot download it, you cannot print it, and we can expire the document. So expiring the access to the document.
Okay, thank you so much for your presentation and the amazing questions.